Worship at Metropolitan Community Church of Richmond. It's good to see you all here on this beautiful, beautiful fall day. So I want to start this morning by filling you in on a couple of things. Those of you that are new to MCC Richmond that do not know, I spent most of my life living in Southern California, and the last 15 years I was there, I lived in the North Hollywood area where we have a lot of pavement and some palm trees. So when I moved to Richmond and I experienced my first fall here, my fall allergies started to go crazy, and we took care of that. But I have never, ever tired of the beauty of looking down Monument Avenue and seeing the beautiful trees. So if you're here in Richmond, take advantage of those beautiful trees outside and the changing colors of them. And if you're not from Richmond, I promise this week on social media, we'll put some pictures for you so you can enjoy it too. The other thing I have to let you know is I was called an amazing name yesterday. And I want you all to know that your pastor, I had a conversation with a couple that I have never spoken with before. It was a beautiful conversation, but one person had the unmitigated gall to call me a flaming homo liberal Democrat. At which, exactly. At which I said to myself, oh, they know me. What a compliment. But the beauty of that conversation was that they were kind of making amends for their thoughts about who this church is and what they've said about this church, but their opinion changed, and it changed as we encountered COVID, and they saw the lines for the food pantry. They saw us feeding the food pantry on the front steps of the church. They were curious about what was going on here. And then when we were able to invite people back for worship in person, they said they see people arriving in masks, and when they leave, they are happier than when they come, and they're socially distanced, even after church. And the reason this is so important is this gentleman's mother died this week, and they asked me to do the graveside service for her celebration of life. And that's how God shows up. It's not so much always what we say, although the pastor tends to say some pretty cool things, don't you know? It's not always what we say. It's our behavior, and it's our actions of what we do. And so today, let us all celebrate that we are worshiping a God who reminds us that we are loved, a God who gives us opportunities to share God's transforming love with others. Amen? Amen. If you're worshiping with us in the sanctuary, we invite you to raise your hand if you did not get a communion cup when you enter the sanctuary. Tom or Mike will be glad to make sure that you get one so that when we get to the holy meal, you can participate with us fully in this experience. If you're worshiping online, we invite you to get a cup of juice or coffee or wine, whatever you'd like to drink, and a cracker, a donut, or a piece of toast. To eat so that when we get to the Holy Meal, you too can participate with us fully. We also invite those of you at home to get a candle so that when we light the Christ candle together in the sanctuary, we will be forming community literally around the world. We each and every week, we invite you to send me an email from where you are worshiping this week. We know that a lot of people worship during the week, and we think that's a fantastic idea. Send an email to godguykenny@gmail.com, godguykenny @gmail.com, and let us know from where you are worshiping. This past week, I received emails from people who worshiped in, are you ready for this? Florida, Georgia, North and South Carolina, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Alabama, Amsterdam. Yeah, Kirk and I caused some trouble there when we were on vacation. Amsterdam, South Dakota, Oregon, Washington, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, New York, Michigan, Colorado, India, Hawaii, New Mexico, Arizona, Richmond, Virginia, Henrico, Glen Allen, and Verina. Welcome your MCC Richmond family. We also invite those of you that are worshiping online to use the chat box on Facebook to welcome one another. Kind of see who's worshiping with us and welcome them. And people that they are welcome here. Each and every one of you are welcome here. And I believe that God has special things for us today during our time of worship. And I hope and pray, and our intention is, that you would meet with the living God in whatever way that means for you this day. So let us begin our worship as we stand and we sing together. We've come this far by faith. God is present here because we are here together. And together we are going to experience great and amazing things. Each and every week we set our intention for this service by hearing the words of Reverend Sharon Wiley, her words of wholeness. And so this morning I invite you to make yourself comfortable wherever you are. And if you would like to close your eyes, please do so. If you would like to cross your legs, do so. If you would just like to just and experience the goodness of God's presence and the goodness of God's love and claim these words of wholeness. Reverend Sharon reminds us that we speak so often of brokenness in religious life. Let us today speak of wholeness. You are welcome here in this space, all of you, every part of you, beautiful, absolutely stunningly beautiful, just the way you are. Here you do not need to be something more or something less. There's no holding back here, no hiding here, no exerting yourself, no trying to do more or to be more. Because you have an errant word. You have nothing, absolutely nothing to prove to me or to the person sitting next to you or to anyone. You don't have to try and be more witty or more quiet or more outgoing. Every part of you beautiful, just the way you are. You do not need to change anything about yourself. Your skin, your hair, your belly, your limbs, your face, all beautiful. That's the way they are. Ordinary. Because you were created in the image of a loving God. Every one of you, different from each and everyone else, and beautiful in your own. God said, with this intention, let us continue to worship our living God together as we sing our theme song for the month, Love Can Build a Bridge.
Yes, I think it's time.
Amen.
This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall
rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen. And in that state of rejoicing, I welcome our visitors and family here in the sanctuary, as well as our viewers in virtual land. And it's the joy that brings us together. It's the joy that strengthens us. So as we form community, our beloved community globally, let us stay in that place of joy. As our viewers light their candles at home, I would ask T to come forth and light our candle here. And this is our Christ candle, affirming that we are the lights. We are the workers that the world so needs. We light this candle for ourselves, but for those that yet know who they are in God, yet know that they are the beloved, and God loves them just the way they are. And as we stay in that place of welcomeness and joyfulness, let us greet each other in like manner. And we say our greeting together with gusto and truth. It doesn't matter who you are, where you've been, what you've done, how you love, or who you love. God welcomes you, and so do we. You all are welcome here. And with that state of welcomeness, we invite the Holy Spirit, the Ruah, the life source and giver of all things. As we enter into our time, we close our eyes to unite, knowing that we use and we are in the presence of oneness. We take in a breath. knowing that that breath also takes us in. And we hold it for a second, appreciating with gratitude and grace all that it means individually and collectively. Now we let it go. Release it. Release the peace and the joy. Give it to your neighbor sitting next to you. Share it with your neighbor around the corner. Let it go. Now let's take in another breath. With intention, with purpose, meaning, this breath is the life that grounds you, that wakes you in the morning, that watches over you at night, that guides you through your day. With grace and gratitude, release this one again to yourself, to your neighbor, to the world, knowing that what you release has power, for it is the fullness thereof, the isness of who you are. Now let's take in our last breath, the breath that says you are eternal, the breath that says you are more than enough, the breath that says, I love you, I am always with you, I will never abandon you. Now let it go with gratitude as we give thanks for this time, for the breath that breathes on us, the breath that breathes for us, the sanctuary of our soul. And we say together, amen, and so it is.
Good morning. Won't you please pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we join our hearts in prayer as a community on a faith journey together. We seek to know you better and to follow the path that you have set for us. Help us to wait for the unfolding of your will with patience and assurance. We are in awe over the beauty that surrounds us. When our eyes gaze upon the vibrant colors of fall, or the rosy cheeks of a beloved child, or we hear the song of a bird resting here from a journey of thousands of miles, we cannot help but realize the glorious oneness of all of your creation. We are one. We pray for those who are grieving and that need comfort. We pray for those in need of healing of mind, of body, or spirit. We pray for those who are without employment or shelter or nourishment, for those ravaged by war and violence. We pray for our state and for our nation and for those who are called to serve and lead. May the servant's heart truly be theirs. God, you bring to our hearts and minds the names of those who are in need, and we speak them aloud right now. God, sometimes we cannot even verbalize our need, but through our wordless sighs, you are there. May our worry be displaced by the joy and hope that only you can bring. Thank you, God. We thank you, for we are all full of answered prayers. Help us to be strong in our faith and in our love. Show us how we can help those in need, and give us the strength and courage to step out to meet that need. We are grateful for this community of faith and the ways that we come together to make a difference in people's lives. Forgive us when we do not live together with mutual love and respect. Teach us each day to love as you do. And may your Spirit guide us and unite us. And we ask all of these things in all of your holy names, and in the name of Jesus, amen.
Today's sacred text is taken from Romans, the 5th chapter, verses 2 to 5. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us to grace in which we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to the day on which we will become all that God has intended. But not only that, we even rejoice in our afflictions. We know that affliction produces perseverance, and perseverance, proven character, and character, hope. And such a hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us.
of joy. What a blessing you are. Give them another hand. I love our choir. And for those of you that are not on our email list, we want you to be on the email list, so let us know if you're not. In my letter to the congregation this week, I shared about an experience that the Spirits of Joy had. This past week, we received an email. Jenny received an email in the church office, and the email was from the composer of last week's special number. And the composer's name is Don Biesig. He couldn't believe that he listened to the video of that song that was performed last week. And he told Jenny what a blessing it was to hear a song that he had composed some 30 years ago. And he was so impressed that he let the lyricist know about that video, the YouTube. And then he went to our church website. And then I was like, yeah, then he really found out about MCC Richmond, right? And don't you know, he commented about our ministries and the passion in which we serve. And I thought to myself, isn't this amazing that three different ministries of our congregation, the Spirits of Joy, the music ministry, the sound team, in doing the research to get appropriate microphones for recording and sound that made it possible for the microphones to hear this in our taping so that the social media team, in all of their brilliance, could make a YouTube of that part of the service and blast it all over the world. And lo and behold, the composer heard that. You cannot make this stuff up. This is just the way God rolls around the world and especially around MCC Richmond. So thank you for the cooperation of three different ministries that made a blessing in at least two people's lives, Don Biesig and Nancy Price, who did the lyrics and wrote that song. It's amazing, just amazing. So thank you for that. This is the first week out of three that I've been preaching. And someone said to me this morning, you still got it in you, Pastor. Ooh, I was like, there's a challenge. I mean, yesterday I was defined as, let me say it again because it just rocks my world in a good way. I was defined as a, let's say it together. Let me see, what was the first word? Flaming, imagine that. Flaming homo liberal Democrat. So let me get the glitter going. As I was reading the Romans passage this week, I was so touched by Paul's writing. But I have to be honest with you. The idea of rejoicing in my afflictions does not come easily to me. And I wonder if they come easily for you. It's not that I don't go through them. It's not that I do my best to, but I do my best to avoid suffering. And when I'm suffering or even struggling, I prefer to hide it. I prefer to just deal with it on my own. And I only let a few people in to know when I'm really, really have my back up against the wall. And there are a few reasons for this. I don't want to be a burden to others, and I don't like it when I even have to admit to myself that I'm having a tough time. And I don't want to appear weak in a culture that defines strength in terms of power rather than vulnerability or suffering. You see, well, you know what I mean. Can you relate to that, church? But you know what got me this week is the Apostle Paul does not agree with me. Imagine that. And the Apostle Paul does not to share any of my reasons for not wanting to suffer or to let you in when I'm suffering. Rather, the Apostle Paul in his writing believes that affliction and suffering are simply a part of life. And when we approach them from the point of view of our faith, that they can actually lead to growth in our confidence and awareness of God's presence and transforming love. Now, right there, I was outdone. Absolutely outdone. And thought, oh, I got to preach on this. But it's really important that we understand that this does not mean that Paul in any way is advocating for suffering's sake. Nor does he believe that God intends for us to suffer. Far from it. Rather, from Paul's ministry and his teaching, he reminds us that we worship a God who surprises us by showing up exactly where we are, including showing up in the middle of our vulnerability, in the middle of our discomfort, in the middle of our pain, and in the middle of our suffering. I have to tell you, as I reviewed this time and place in Paul's life, this was a surprise to Paul's first century audience, and it's likely a surprise to us today. The problem is, I believe, that the church has taught us to think of God only in terms of strength and power. And so we assume that that's what God looks for in return, until we realize that the divine is a God of love, a God of compassion, and that God accepts every part of us. And how? Just the way we are. And that means we're going to go through vulnerability and suffering because we indeed are human, made in the image of a loving God, and we cannot ever forget that truth. Because then you'll forget your purpose, and you'll forget who God is. And when you see other people, you'll be reminded of their humanness and their God, and that's what gives us the power to get up and get out of bed every morning. Amen. For most of Paul's life, Paul believed that the best way to meet the living God was through strict spiritual discipline and complete obedience to God's laws and displaying the kind of faith that moves mountains. And you can tell that I think, oh yeah, that's a bunch of BS right there, right? But when Paul, who began his career by persecuting the church, remember when Paul was Saul? And then Paul had this encounter with God, an encounter that changed his name, Paul. When Paul had a meaningful life experience with the divine, he was changed profoundly. And his ideas about who God is and where we can expect God to meet us were turned completely upside down. Think about it. Who would imagine that God would show up in God's Messiah, showing up as a convicted criminal, put to death in the most awful of ways, surrounded by two thieves, suffering a weak and pitiful death, as one can imagine? That thought simply astounded Paul, just like it surprises us, and forced him, and I hope it forces us, to think about God differently. God is not waiting until we become good enough or strong enough or righteous enough to come to us. That's right. Thank you, God. Thank you, Reverend Georgia. Rather, God comes to meet us exactly where we are, including our weakness, including our struggles, and our vulnerability, in order to comfort us and strengthen us and to encourage us. And you know what else happens in those times? We get loved up even more than what we can ever imagine, loved up when we need it the most. And God is with us, not only in our also in those times of utter joy and happiness, those times when we think that life just cannot get better, like that conversation I had yesterday, cannot get better, because I am seen by the neighbors as who I am. And I celebrate that. But you know, church, one thing I've learned throughout my entire ministry And I heard it in Sunday school this morning. I was cheering them on when they were discussing this. When we are not in some kind of emotional or physical discomfort, we often don't acknowledge our deep need for the divine. And yet, God is present with us all the time, showering us with transforming, never-ending love and grace at all times. And yet, the strange but yet wonderful truth is, just like the Apostle Paul, when we experience this realization of God's presence, when we're really hurting, when our world is crumbling and we think we're losing our mind, and God shows up in a way that is tangible and meaningful for us, then we realize that there's nothing that we go through that together God will not help us be thriving in and overcoming, because that is the essence of God. That is the essence of love. That is the essence of living in the kingdom of God right here, right now, each and every day. When we have this kind of deep and meaningful spiritual experience, we are not only motivated to share it with others, but we can identify the pain and brokenness. That's the elevator. The pain and the brokenness in somebody else, so that we can help them get through those times. And that's the times when being part of a spiritual community really comes in handy. Because as we share with one another, we realize that we're not alone, that we have one another, and that we can be reminded of God's presence and God's love in our life. I believe that this is one of the reasons we of MCC Richmond are so passionate about outreach, because we understand what it feels like to be put out, to be thrown out, to be not welcomed, to be ignored and overlooked and even marginalized. But when we see this happening to others, we know what to do, because we know how to be conquerors over those things. We know how to let people know who we are so they do define us by our truth. Flaming, homo, liberal, Democrat. That's right. Tell it like it is. And somebody who will always listen to you, to hear and ask, what is God doing? It was so hard for me yesterday. I was so blown away when this couple came to speak to me. But the thing that I kept saying was, why is this information important for me to hear? What is going on? Why do I need to listen, and why do I need to keep my mouth shut? Now there's the miracle of God right there. Because, you know, I would usually be on my soapbox, you know. How dare you, you know. But the truth was, it was important for this couple to make amends, to what was going on. You are welcome here, brother. Go ahead and get a seat. Hello? Go ahead and get a seat. Yes. Okay, I'll be willing to meet with you right after the service. Okay, go ahead. All the time, God is good. So I've been thinking about this experience in light of Paul's teaching and relating it to what many of us are experiencing with the realities, the ongoing changes of COVID. Recently, several people have shared with me their frustrations with all the changes that are constantly seem to be happening, that they are experiencing, and the ongoing fear of being infected with COVID, even though they have been fully vaccinated. Each and every one of us are dealing with this reality. Some are feeling that they are letting other people down because they are not willing or able to have the same level of activity or engagement during these days of the pandemic. I have a few things to say about that. The first thing I want to let you know is that if you are feeling anxious or stressed or frightened over what seems like an unending list of changes beyond your control, not only are you not alone, this is a very normal reaction. This is a very normal response to any pandemic. You are also not somehow disappointing or failing others as you process and share your feelings and your struggles. Rather, you are being honest. You're letting people into your world, and you're facing something that makes everyone vulnerable, and being truthful about the dramatic, challenging nature of our shared circumstances. And sometimes it takes somebody showing us how to process and how to talk about things that are painful to let God in. It might be helpful for each and every one of us to remember that courage is not the absence of fear or vulnerability, but rather is the ability to persevere and to work through the realities of fear and vulnerability. Stop for just a minute and think, can you come up with one example of courage that did not, on some level, involve vulnerability? Think about that for your own. This is where Paul's teaching helps us remember that hope and our faith can make as we do our best to remember that God is with us, and we confront and work through the many challenges of life and ever-changing realities of this pandemic together, welcoming the fears, welcoming the concerns, welcoming the tears and more, as honest expressions of both the vulnerability, the solidarity that we our relationship. And then second, as a spiritual community, we'll remind each other that God chooses to meet us precisely where we are, which includes our weaknesses and vulnerability. I love that baby's speaking up right at this moment. That baby's saying, that's right, Pastor, keep up, keep going. I still got it after 3 weeks, I love it. So God chooses to meet us precisely where we are, which includes our weakness and our vulnerability, because God shows up in times and places in our lives when we least expect God, reminding us that God always loves us and accepts every part of us, which includes the parts of ourselves that we have a hard time accepting and even loving ourselves. I believe this is what Paul means by saying that afflictions can lead to perseverance, and perseverance to character, and character to hope. Because when you realize that God is with you and for you, that God is always on your side, especially when things are tough in your world, no matter what, that God loves you more than what you could ever, ever imagine. And then I believe that you'll find a way not simply to survive challenges, but to thrive in and during them. Because you let people in, you let the living God in, and that will rock your world. Rock your world. And as you thrive, you'll see God. And as we think about thriving, I have to tell you, that's one of the things that we at MCC. No matter what circumstances we find ourselves facing, we do everything within our power to remind ourselves and others that we are all loved and celebrated as the beloved of God, just the way that we are, no matter what circumstances together, we openly share our experiences. We share our joys and our troubles with one another. And together we remind each other of God's transforming love and presence with us while supporting and praying for one another. This is huge, absolutely huge, and we need it so much. And just when we begin to doubt or question or find ourselves losing our mind in fear or perhaps even in grief, God shows up through a phone call or a card or a text message or an email or a conversation when you're taking leave from a friend, a colleague, a loved one that will not be a stranger. And when we feel better and are filled with hope, we remember that we are loved. We are loved by God more than what we could ever imagine. Sometimes on a daily, hourly basis, every day, as a spiritual community, we continue to learn ways of using social to reach out to others, to touch lives through worship, to continue to reach out by keeping our ministries alive and thriving. During these days of pandemic, we are determined to do whatever it takes to safely share God in all that we do. Just not some of what we do, but all that we do. And we are constantly learning to serve and minister collaboratively as the people of chosen and called, referred to as the beloved of God. That excites me. Does it excite you, church? Who would have thought before COVID that MCC Richmond would have a worldwide ministry positively touching the lives of people around the globe? I've got emails to prove it. Ministry around the globe. And at the same time, that we would be making a positive difference in the lives of people right here in Richmond, Virginia. Who would have guessed that the Vicki Hester Food Pantry and Bread Ministry would feed and touch hundreds of people each and every week? Who would have guessed that a composer and lyricist would hear the spirits of joy through YouTube and send their thanks and comment on the quality of ministries and the blessings of them? You know who thought about all this? God did. And God uses each and every one of us to not only make those things a reality, but to remind us always hope, that there's always hope. At the same time, we at MCC Richmond know the blessings of God, and we need to share God's love and presence with others as we support one another with confidence that, just as Paul said, such a hope does not disappoint. Why is that? Because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. That is hope. That is motivation. The truth is, life just doesn't get much better than this. Growing as individuals, celebrating the divine in others and in our own lives, and loving God by caring for and serving others, our mission statement. We will get through this pandemic, and we'll get through it together. And when we do, we may be surprised 5 years from now when we look back and we realize that through the pandemic, just like Paul says, we were able to grow in our faith, to grow in our confidence that God uses us just where we are in our lives. and our awareness of God's presence, God's transforming love, and God's grace. Now that, my friends, is hope. And
I've got feet like a river, I've got feet like a river,
I've got feet like a river
in my soul,
in my soul.
I've got feet
like a river, I've got feet like a river,
I've got feet like a river in my soul. I've got love like a river, I've got love like a river. I've got love like a river, I've got love like a river in my soul. I've got love like a river, I've got love like a river in my soul. I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean.
Good morning, everybody. So before we say our offering prayer, I had to confess something. I used to, I'm still afraid of giving out the offering prayer. I've done a lot of things for the church, but I used to not like doing this because I used to think that there were others that did these wonderful offering prayers, like Miss Ricky over there, who looks so fabulous, by the way. But, she says these amazing prayers. And so I used to think, well, I don't think I'm good enough to do that. But then a couple weeks ago, I heard John Porch, he's not here today, but he said that he didn't like it either. And then I said, well, okay, I guess I get to have the courage to do this, so I'm going to do it. And I also thought about I also used to think that doing the offering was like selling a product or something like that. And I'm like, oh, I'm not a good salesperson. God. But then I realized that God is not a Toyota or a Starbucks, for that matter. So I love the pumpkin spice latte. But, God is so much more than that. And God loves us no matter what, whether even if we stumble upon prayers or if we say the wrong thing, God's love is unconditional. And so as you think about giving either here in the sanctuary or at mccrichmond.org /giving, think of the love that God has for you, and don't feel tricked into thinking that giving is for the pastor, but think of the love of God and how much he loves you and how much in turn you should love him. So now let us pray. God, truly, you are our servants. We are your servants, actually. And in you, we live and move and have our being. We offer you thanks and call on your name. We love you, God, for you hear us and respond in graciousness and compassion and righteousness. You, in all days and in this day, deliver our souls from death, our feet from stumbling, and our eyes from tears. Now receive these tithes and offerings, and we pray you multiply them so that your work and word can go forth. Amen.
Come now, just as you are, experience this. Let us observe a moment of reflection as we silently confess our concerns and shortcomings to God before we are fed this. Let us say together, loving and gracious God, forgive those things we have left undone that have caused pain to you, others, and ourselves. Help us to learn from these things and remind us of your forgiving presence and blessed people of God. Through the life and ministry of Jesus, God forgives us, God heals us, and showers us of hope and grace, just the way we are, welcomes us to this feast of victory. And in the many names of our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, we embrace all that is holy as we say together, Holy One, God of power and might, you fill the earth with your justice and transforming love. Blessed is the one who brings hope and welcome to all. All praise, glory, and honor to you, our God. We remember Jesus' promises to his disciples long ago and to us that he will always be with us. We remember how on the night before his betrayal and arrest, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks for the bread, and then he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We remember how after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks for the cup, he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my love poured out for you and for everyone. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. By the love and grace of God, may this bread and cup be the body and love of Jesus for us and with us. In preparation for sharing this meal and mystery, let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us partake of God's gifts of forgiveness, love, and grace. Pray together. Holy One, we give you thanks for the ways that you not only meet us where we are, but the ways that you remind us that we are loved, the ways that you remind us. Help us to persevere anything that we do, knowing that we are not alone, knowing that we have one another, and that
That's encouragement. That's for me. Pray all of this in all your many names, especially in the name. All say together, may it be so. I have a few announcements that I would like to make this morning. The first of which is what happens on Tuesday? Voting days. And maybe you too will be known as a flaming homo liberal. Just saying. This is an important vote for us. And who would have thought that America would be looking at Virginia? But let's make them proud. Amen? Amen. We're still looking for people that are willing to make soup for the coats, the coat, hat, scarves, and glove giveaway that we're partnering with Daily Planet and Anthem Women's Group. Please, if you can make soup, let me know. There were several people who said last week they would, but we can still use more. Next Sunday is All Saints Sunday. And on this day, I would invite you to bring framed pictures of loved ones who have passed this year or people that you just want to remember that have died. You can also bring a memento that was important to that helped you remember them. There'll be a table in front of the altar, please, to put them on the table when you arrive for worship. Also, remember that the congregational meeting is coming up. We will, before the congregational meeting on the 14th of November at 1:30 via Zoom, we will have the budget forum. At the budget forum, the purpose of this gathering is so that we will present the budget for 2022, and we would invite you to ask questions about the budget. Traditionally, that's a smaller meeting, so it's easier to hear people's questions via Zoom. For the congregational meeting, we would like for there not to be questions about the budget. Of course, if somebody has one and they type one in, we will not ignore that. But we are trying to answer all the budget questions at the budget forum. In preparation for the congregational meeting, if there's something that you think is important for the board to address about our ministry, or if you have a question, we're asking you those questions in writing to the church office or to Philip Adams, our clerk, so that we will be able to address them at the congregational meeting. The congregational meeting is going to be larger, and again, it's very difficult on Zoom to be able to hear people's questions and to even know when they want to ask a question. So we know that there are some things that you might want addressed in this meeting other than the budget. So please, if you have questions, don't feel like you can't ask them. We want to be able to address them, but we ask that they be in by November 7th. Please note, again, this is for your questions for any of the business of the but we ask that budget questions happen at the budget forum. Does that make sense? Okay, great. Also, don't forget to send me an email from where you're worshiping today. My email address again is godguykenny@gmail.com, GodGuyKenny at gmail.com. And let me know from where you're worshiping. And whatever you face this week, face it with pride, knowing that all will be well.
All will be well.